Captain Foss and his men were part of the American effort to hold on to Henderson Field, the dirt and coral landing strips named after one of the heroes of Midway. The Marines held tight to the small area, but Japanese attacks were frequent and lethal. Bombs and shells left craters and dead Marines in the American camp. When he wasn't dodging shells and bombs on the ground, Joe Foss was in the air, dodging enemy planes in his Grumman F-4F Wildcat. He was also building a reputation as a marksman. On October 13th, he downed his first Zero. The next day, his second. On October 15th, two Zeros and a bomber. With five confirmed shootdowns, Joe Foss had reached ace status. But five was just the beginning. On October 20th, two Zeros. On October 23rd, four more. And October 25th, five. Within 13 days, Joe Foss shot down 16 enemy planes. On the home front, civilians were taking notice. Journalists had been reporting daily on the successes of the South Dakota farm boy. The American public was becoming familiar with the faraway battlefield called Guadalcanal, and the name, Joe Foss. At Henderson Field, many of the air battles happened directly overhead.
All of the first fighting was over the field. I got shot down three times that I landed on the field. So that indicates everybody could watch what was going on. And of course, they liked to see the enemy aircraft coming down. And fortunately, it was the majority of the enemy coming down for the people that were in our small area. And they'd stand out there in the wide open. I don't know how come a lot of them didn't get shot by the, or just killed by the lead or casings falling on their head.
Joe was shot down four times, including once in the ocean, 84 miles from Henderson Field, and he nearly died. During all of his military training, Joe Foss had never learned to swim. He struggled to unhook his parachute and free himself from his sinking plane. He finally got out and was carried 30 feet to the surface by his May West life jacket. He was afloat, but afraid. Bob Lee, who worked closely with Joe later in life, tells the story of the rescue.
He was floating around there, and there was a Belgian missionary on this island who saw the plane go down. And he set out some natives in a canoe to rescue this pilot. And it was about dusk, and Joe was floating around there, and it got dark, and he heard some voices, but they were speaking a strange language, and he thought they were Japanese, so he didn't say anything. Finally, he heard somebody say, "Well, turn that flashlight over here," in English. Well, then he yelled out, and it was this Belgian missionary, and they fished him out of the Pacific and brought him to this island.
Joe was rescued and sent back to Henderson Field, thankful to be alive. His tally of enemy planes continued to grow. By mid-November, he had shot down 23 enemy planes. The name of Joe Foss was becoming famous worldwide. Bullets and bombs couldn't bring down Captain Foss, but mosquitoes did. In mid-November, Joe was knocked out of action with a serious case of malaria. The disease, with its chills and fever, afflicted thousands of soldiers on both sides during the war in the Pacific. He was shipped out first to New Caledonia for medical attention, then to Australia for a few weeks of R&R. It was here that Joe first realized he was becoming famous. News of the battles at Guadalcanal had been front page material there. In January of 1943, Joe returned to Guadalcanal. By the end of the month, he tied the record of legendary World War I ace Eddie Rickenbacker with 26 confirmed kills. The Marine Corps decided that instead of further risking his life, Captain Foss could be of more use on the home front. In 5 months, he had gone from being a young man with a dream of combat to a returning hero. His skills and knowledge would help train new pilots, and his fame could be used to promote the war effort.